Okay, thanks everybody for coming out here. I can actually speak Dutch, but would you rather me speak English or Dutch? Any preference? I speak English much better. much better. Maar ja, dankjewel allemaal dat je hebt de mooie afternoon toch zien hier te komen. Okay, so you just heard Hans reading about the kind of androgynous figures that we are, and I just wanted to read this. It's from an old Kashmiri, old Indian hymn to Shiva. They're, you know, great god, but he's a kind of a formless god, Shiva. And this is what the poet says, Upala Deva. You dominate one state, another is dominated by Bhavani. Pregnant with all of material creation, ultimately, there is no difference between Devi, the three worlds, and you. That's Upta Vade. Okay, I spent a lot of time in India, and I wanted to read a poem which I wrote. You know what? I'm going to read this one. This is a book that was translated into Dutch by Simon Twinkenog and his wife Barbara Moore years ago when they lived together. But I always treasured this book. I haven't read from it in a long time. This is one called Golden Arrows, and it's dedicated to the great visionary American poet Philip Lamantia, who also recently went to the other world. Golden Arrows. Death is stalking me with 8 golden arrows in her hand and her eyes streaming with tears of neglected love. Death is stalking me with the wisdom of a saint, ancient ash poured upon her right thigh, flaming light pouring from the left. Death watches with her ancient eyes fixed upon my birthplace, her deliberate energy set to annihilate me. Death has no mercy. She haunts me with each turning of the leaf, with every pore ancient to consume my poetic past. She is following me past the far interiors of the night. Philip Lamantia. And this is a poem, it's called Raga. Even when I was in India, you could feel that the tradition was slowly dying. You know, it had this great height, and then it was slowly kind of diminishing. And a teacher of mine said to me, Annapurna Devi, who was the wife of Ali Akbar Khan, or the sister of Ali Akbar Khan, the wife of Ravi Shankar, she said to me, this music was made for the gods. When the kings wanted to hear it, it began to die. And this is a poem for the ragas. Raga. The dancers vanish. One by one they fall upon the calm and coral shores, dropping pearlescent shawls and raising their ivory arms. They implore the winds and sacred waves torn with the ancient song. Their voices haunt the Orphic sands, mourn in hollowed streets, shadowed with the broken boughs of cedar and dried cypress. In robes of woven silk, they seek the emerald moon, burning their white sleeves on frenzied branches. They pluck the fruits of lunacy and consecrate their longing to the passive sea. Dawn's frail hour extinguishes these occult swans who mesmerize the evening shadows and turn the skies with seraphic ferns from the Isles. And I'll read one more. It's called Correspondence. This is kind of poems from my youth, but it's still, yeah, okay. It's called Correspondence. Sometimes I'm already on the caravan that leads to the tombs, to the cafe with the vermilion colored glass pipes and the men staring. Sometimes I've already crossed the threshold of a door, where you stand as you once stood, waiting to receive me. Sometimes I'm on the other side of the forest, where the alder pines no longer disturb with their mystery and their secret. Okay. that's from the bottom there. I'd like to read a couple of more modern poems. These are really beautiful books that were made in Nepal. Ira Cohn had that great Barrow Matrix Press in Kathmandu, and then a young kind of sadhu in America, Shiv Miribito, took up the tradition and made these beautiful rice paper books. Of course, all of these presses and the whole scene there is in ruins now. So I'll dedicate these two poems to Nepal, or hope the people there, you know, get the assistance they need and can rebuild their towns. This one is called Granada. And I think it was written in New York when there was a headline in the Daily News, like, you know, traces of LSD found above Seville, something like that. It was so absurd. So this is for Granada. Above Granada, the acid air still reeks of Morris intention, while above New York City, the radioactivity is hidden from view. Above Seville, LSD creates the havoc we once celebrated, while on East 9th Street, Danny takes pictures of the chemtrails. The genocidal spirit that prevailed on the battlefield now prevails in the medicine cabinet. Oh, you who poison and obscure, look to Granada for comfort. You who turn the air to poison, who tell me free water is a crime. And this is one I'm kind of famous for, or infamous for not living anywhere, but it's not really true, but people like this myth, so I have to always deal with it. I mean, it has some truth if you own a big villa, but if you're just a person who lives in, you know, rooms and stuff. Okay, this is called Buddhist Address. Everyone has trouble with my address. Does it exist or not? Actually, this trouble is in their minds, like all trouble. Dorje Wanchuk never has any trouble with my address. He knows, even though, or because he doesn't know me, that what I write on the envelope in the upper left-hand corner is going to be where I'm at. That's why I like those Rinpoches. They always seem to know where one is at. Okay, for the people of Nepal, we wish our best. Now, to finish this brief poetic offering, I'm going to read from the booklet which Bart brilliantly, and to my surprise, included in the LP he published? No, he produced. And I really thank him, there he is, thank you, Bart. That LP kind of changed my life. And it's called From the Ming Oracle. And in this case, Ming is a plant, the Ming Aurelia, which grew on Church Street in the window of the great American composer Lamont Young. And I worked in his dream house, and one of my jobs was to give away shoots of this plant. So I called it From the Ming Oracle. Okay, this poetry is it's the last chapter of a book I printed myself when Simone died, Simone Trinkenau. And Bart and I just decided we use that last chapter and the title of that last chapter. You can look at it later, it's over there on the table. Okay, so I'll just read from the booklet, first poem. To once meet you, as I did, in a marketplace in Amsterdam, will explain to the world why Louise cannot rest. Why she seeks you, day and night seeks you. Louise moves along the outer rim, from tree to tree, wandering, hungry. She has found you once and will find you again. Hidden in the forest, near the house of her elders, in a pool of leaves, a woman of stone. When she said, I am black, black as night, then you said, I am white, white as the swan you saw on the water. You said, I am the color of the sun. You said you had no color. Finally, I understood, I unbound my hair and understood your nature. They called her crazy, that girl who forgot her own name. She was not fit for your court of nobles, that unkempt girl, but you took her. You held her hand for all to see. printed on her hand a red R, printed on her heart of hearts, you. One day the king asked her for taxes. Money, she replied, is for those who have never slept in the bedchamber of the king. She was excused her debt to the state. While the Christians of the land and the Muslims of the land argued, while the Jews demanded their rights descend from heaven, only for them, you and she met in a garden beyond dialogue. First you said she is fire, then you said she is water. Finally you admitted your mouth was dry, dry with the nature of silence. And when she kissed you, speech flowed like a river and was not superfluous. Some say the world was conceived in the elements of a distant star decayed. Others say we live in imagination only. If I dreamed your nature, did you dream my presence? Sai libera, you are free, you one day asks. Thank you. I'm not going to read it. You can read it yourself. I'm going to start out playing Sarangi here, and I've invited Bart and Anne to join me. Bart? Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I Thank you.